Christ is risen.
Truly is risen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. As we arrive at our first Sunday following Pascha, we come to that infamous moment between Thomas the disciple and Christ himself, as told to us in today's gospel lesson. So last Sunday at Agape Vespers, we heard the first portion of Thomas's story, and today's reading picks up where we left off. Last week we heard Thomas express that unless I see in his hands the print of the nails and place my finger in the marks of the nails and place my hand in his side, I will not believe. And this verse was just read aloud for us again today, after which we're given the conclusion to the story. Now, poor Thomas throughout history, modern history, I should say, because of his skepticism, has been given the unfortunate nickname of Doubting Thomas, which sadly has given him a somewhat sullied reputation in our modern time. And this is to say his expression of doubt in this moment is what has come to define him, despite his having been a rather faithful disciple. Our former priest in New York City, Father Jim Cordaris, who is a wonderful man, he once used an illustration of the former NFL defensive end Jim Marshall to highlight the plight of Thomas's situation. Playing for the Minnesota Vikings one day in late October of 1964, Jim Marshall picked up a fumbled ball from the opposing team, the 49ers, and quickly made a dash for the end zone. And after sprinting across the goal line, Marshall abruptly realized he hadn't scored a touchdown for the Vikings, but had actually went the other way and awarded two unintended points to the 49ers. So this blunder earned him the nickname Wrong Way Marshall, and it would be that single play that he was remembered for many years afterwards, despite having a rather decorated career in the NFL. Of course, we Bostonians were not unfamiliar with this type of thing. Poor Bill Buckner was also known for one single blunder in the 1986 World Series, despite having an otherwise successful MLB career. And this on-field mistake didn't so much earn him a nickname in this case, but he did get many other names I can't repeat here. In addition to a variety of death threats and other forms of violence, because we're gonna hurl violence because of a stupid game, humanity. Both Jim Marshall and Bill Buckner in these examples help illumine the old adage that people will always remember the bad things you did and always forget the good that you've done. Thomas the disciple is no different in this instance. And if we look back through his discipleship journey starting in John 11, we see Thomas express his desire to go with Jesus to the region of Bethany, where it just so happened that many of the religious leaders were waiting there to stone him. Here Thomas exclaims to the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." Now, Thomas may not have known exactly, truly, who Jesus was at that point, but he was ready to follow him unto the end. And furthermore, our Orthodox tradition teaches us that following Christ's ascension, Thomas went on to found churches in Palestine, Mesopotamia, and Ethiopia. And many of the Christian communities in India today actually trace their entire lineage back to Thomas. But because he expressed the need for a little more evidence in this one instance we heard about in today's reading, this particular episode has become the one moment for which he's most often remembered. Now, personally speaking, I don't think we can really fault Thomas for asking for a little proof to what might otherwise be a rather outlandish claim. And in earnest, I think any of us might have expressed the same measure of skepticism in that moment, and in fact, few of the disciples actually did. If we recall in Luke 24, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and a few of the other women rushed from the empty tomb to tell the disciples about Christ's resurrection from the dead. And Luke tells us that the disciples, these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. Peter thereafter rushes off to the tomb to verify the resurrection for himself. And then a few verses later, we find two other disciples actually walking side by side with Jesus on the road to Emmaus, and they don't even recognize him. They speak to him all along thinking he's someone else entirely while still believing Jesus to be dead. So I'd like to offer that asking for proof in situations like these isn't so much an expression of faithlessness or doubt, but simply a way to confirm the veracity of a given supposition. In the internet age, we don't have to look very far to see how prevalent outlandish and false claims can be. Perhaps more startling is how quickly these falsehoods can spread. Social media has no shortage of quick fix weight loss solutions, youth serums, pseudoscientific remedies for flu and cold, evidence that aliens built the pyramids, and definitive proof that the Earth is actually flat. And of course, none of these claims are made by actual scientists in their field. So a healthy dose of skepticism in moments like these aren't all that out of line. And when it comes to matters of faith, the Orthodox Church and Christianity in general aren't immune to unsubstantiated claims. Because these claims are made in the name of God, we then tend to let them go unquestioned. We're afraid to show a little healthy skepticism because we feel, maybe I'm questioning God, or perhaps I'm doubting a miracle. We just fear being on the wrong side of, that for what it might reveal to us about our own faith. During the lockdown, I heard many unsubstantiated claims about the coronavirus and what it can or cannot do to any of the faithful seeking to gather for divine services. If you're in a church, one online personality said, you can't get sick. Another YouTuber insisted that the Eucharist was his vaccine. So at the very least, we should always remember that the spirit, that the image of the church given to us by our tradition is as a hospital for the spiritually ill. And the Eucharist, furthermore, is our spiritual medicine. And while miracles can and do happen, what we receive from the chalice is not a magic potion promising physical immortality. So it's good for us to remember that a healthy expression of skepticism does not make you a faithless individual who doubts the work of God. It means you're using the brain that God gave you to not only understand God more faithfully, but to know better what God is not. God is not a being who demands we reject accepted science in exchange for fundamentalist conjectures. Science, by contrast, can actually show us more about the ordered detail of the cosmos than any one religious text can supply us today. And likewise, the writings of the holy fathers and mothers of our church can reveal to us how to plumb the depths of the heart and in a far deeper manner than any one cardiologist could have ever dreamed. Remember, we don't need to be afraid of things that are true. Things that are true simply are. And what is true, therefore, cannot be found to be heretical. I'd like to share a different example about how we should be directing our energies in a world filled with outlandish claims and as a way of sorting out supernatural phenomena from genuine miracles. A dear friend of mine who was once a monk relayed a story from inside his former monastery. Apparently, a group of them had become obsessed with the idea of levitation during prayer. So one of them claimed to have seen a fellow monk floating in his cell. And this soon became an obsession among the other novices and caused a bit of a commotion to the daily order of things in the monastery. So wisely, the abbot soon stepped in and said, "Brothers, listen up. I am the one who hears all your confessions in here. No one in this monastery is levitating. Go back to your chores." Right? Focus a little less on the claims of others and focus a little more on yourself and your own salvation. That's the heart of that message, and I think it's the right message. This is when someone like the Apostle Thomas can serve as a wonderful example for us. When someone comes to preach a message, make a claim, or tell a godly tale in the name of Christ, we should, like Thomas, always demand to see the marks of Christ on that person who claims to be speaking in God's name before we give ear to what it is they're preaching. To do so is to carry with you a good and healthy measure of skepticism. And of those preachers claiming to be from God, we can and should always ask, how is this person treating other human beings? Is he talking down to them? Is he belittling others? Does this person bear the mark of one touched by resurrection? Or is he simply asking for money? Are they preaching a message out of fear? And are they trying to rile up your passions because of their own fear of other people? When Thomas said, "I will not believe until I see the mark of the nails and until I place my hand in his side," he was simply doing what was properly Orthodox in the truest sense. He wanted to ensure that it was truly the risen Christ before him and not some impostor claiming to be so. Only then would he bow down in worship. And remember, not too long before Christ's own passion, he issued a warning to his disciples saying, "Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and they will lead many astray. If anyone says to you, look, here is the Messiah, or there he is, do not believe it. So perhaps this was on Thomas's mind when he first heard rumors about the resurrection. His asking to see proof is a way of ensuring Christ has truly risen. And notice what happens when Thomas finally does come face to face with Jesus. He does not ask to see the print of the nails as he said. Still, Jesus acquiesces and says, Thomas, place your finger here. But what does Thomas do instead? He simply bows and says, my Lord and my God. The truly risen Christ stood before him and no further proof was needed. So where does that leave us today? Blessed are we who have not seen the way Thomas has seen and yet still believe. Christ is risen.